So, hello everyone. Thanks for coming. So, I'm Daiki. I'll be talking about a bit of cryptography today. So before starting, let me briefly introduce myself. I'm Daiki Ueno. I'm a software engineer at Red Hat. I mainly work on low-level crypto packages in Red Hat Enterprise Linux. So we call it RHEL. And as a fun fact, I lived in Czech Republic for the past 6 years and returned to Japan only last year. So this talk is about our new project called Crypto Auditing. So it is a tool to monitor cryptographic operations performed on a system. So why we are doing this? So a basic assumption is that cryptography is used everywhere. For protecting network traffic, for encrypting disks, for signing packages or containers. So for example, if you just access a random website, you will be typically using HTTPS. That means your connection will be encrypted using TLS, and the server's identity will be verified using PKI and digital signature. So regardless of whether you like or not, you will have to use a cryptographic algorithm every day. But the problem is that the underlying cryptographic algorithm has its own lifetime. So I put a couple of examples here. TripleDes MD5 SHA-1 RSA with small key sizes. These are considered duplicated or even broken. So also, in the next 10 years, it is said that quantum computers will be a real thing. It will easily compromise classical public key algorithms. So there will be more to come to deprecate. And if you keep these legacy algorithms on your system, that could mean that your system will be eventually vulnerable. So let's look at a couple of examples. The first one is SHA-1. Maybe everyone knows it, but it's a secure hash algorithm. It's commonly used for digital signatures. So for traditional digital signature scheme with RSA or ECDSA, it does some hashing before applying the asymmetric crypto. So if a collision can be easily created, that means the digital signature is meaningless because attacker can create a very legit signature from arbitrary text. So 2017, there was a first collision attack was proposed, and 3 years later, there was a much more efficient attack was proposed. So at that time, only $45,000 was needed to just create a collision. So a second example is RSA encryption with PKSS1 padding. So this scheme is still not vulnerable, but it is very hard to use correctly or securely. So if you misuse it, it will create some timing side channels that would leak plain text to the attacker. So first of this kind of attack was proposed in 90s by Brian Bahar. And there were a couple of more variant was proposed recently. The first one is Robot in 2018. And the next one is Marvin, discovered this year. So quite a few number of CVE were assigned for these attacks. So last example is triple handshake attack. TLS transport layer security uses temporary session key to encrypt the traffic. So, but the original TLS 1.2 key derivation process doesn't take into account of the handshake transcript. So that means mind-in-the-middle attacker can intercept the handshake transcript and can impersonate as a client. So, So there was a mitigation proposed in RFC 7627. That is to use the extended master secret extension to generate the key. So it basically binds the handshake transcript to the key derivation. So, okay, so after looking at these examples, I guess most of the people agree that the best practice would be to regularly review your system configuration and tighten the cryptographic algorithms being used on the system. But this process is not so easy, especially for system administrators. They need to be familiar with cryptography and need to follow the recent researches on that. So we created a tool that called Crypto Policies. So this is a tool to provide a system-wide baseline of the cryptographic algorithms. So it's already adopted in Fedora, Rail, and OpenSUSE. So this is a good tool, but there is one problem that if you change the default, there will be likely some pushback from the community, because if you suddenly disable working algorithm, it's not completely broken, and there are some users, they will be upset. So yeah, we went through this process for 3 times, and the latest one is still rejected. So we need a way to identify the actual usage of cryptographic algorithm on the system. So now, with the help of crypto policies, we can tighten the configuration to use the latest set of cryptographic algorithms. So the question is this sufficient? Actually, no, because the implementations also matter. So Red Hat Enterprise Linux include FIPS certified cryptographic modules. So they are, they pass the code review by the separate laboratory and pass the acceptance tests. And also we implement additional requirements like documentation or necessary API. So yeah, that means as long as we use these certified module, we say it's kind of secure. But something could happen. So this was a CVE discovered this year. So we ship dual stack crypto backend in Go applications. If the system is not in the FIPS mode, we use the cryptographic code written in Golang. It is not certified because the code will be copied to everywhere when linking. Instead, in the FIPS mode, we use DLOpen to delegate all the cryptographic operation to the system library. So, but for some reason, this switching was not working. And that means a non-certified implementation was used in FIPS mode. It is already fixed, but we need a way to prevent this kind of issue. So we need a tool for 2 purposes. One is to help tighten algorithm selection, and the other to ensure the correct implementation is being used on the system. The first purpose is can be done with crypto policies, but this means kind of long-term trend analysis. Like 1 year or two year, there will be no user. We can safely disable some algorithms. But the other purpose, to ensure the correct implementation is used, we need more real-time auditing mechanism that indicate which implementation is used when you do some operation that would use cryptographic operations underneath. So that's the introduction. So let's go into the details of this tool we propose. So first one is the goal that We are trying to create an infrastructure to monitor all the cryptographic operations happening on the system. So we want to support all the FIPS certified modules. We also want to support long-term and real-time auditing process. So second one is challenges. There are always challenges for this kind of infrastructure. So crypto auditing shouldn't degrade system performance as a whole. Secondly, privacy is also a concern that we can certainly collect any information from the user, but we shouldn't actively do that. And lastly, maintainability. So what information will be collected, maintained as a rule? So this kind of rules will be larger and larger as this project evolves. So we need to make a way. We need to provide a way to ensure maintenance is easy. So here is the architecture. So we propose the core component is the agent. This agent installs eBPF program into the kernel, and the kernel attaches it to running process to receive the cryptographic operation is happening. So after receiving the event, it sends back the event to the agent, and the agent writes the events into a file in an asynchronous way through IOU link. And this log file is just a normal regular file. So it can be read as normally, but we also provide an event broker service that periodically pulls that file and distribute events to real-time auditor clients. So next thing is logging mechanism. So we decided to use eBPF to trace the user space programs when the cryptographic operation is used. So first, there are multiple ways to do that. One is uproofs and the other is USDT. We first tried to use uproofs, but found out that it's not suitable for this purpose, because it can only monitor enter and exit of function calls. So why it doesn't work? Let's look at the OpenSSL signature API. So just to create a single signature, we need to call five functions. So if we track all of them, the tracking process will be quite heavy and complicated. On the other hand, if we use USDT, user statically defined trace point, we can put arbitrary trace point to any binary. Yeah, it brings us a lot of flexibility, but the problem is that we need to somehow maintain the proof points by ourselves and hopefully upstream this proof points implementation to the projects. So let's look at the file format. So our file format is quite simple CBOA format, but in higher level, it is organized as a hierarchical manner. So for example, this indicates a TLS client handshake, and it takes some time, and during that period, there is some certificate verification event, and there is one event, RSA size, 3,000 kilobit RSA key is used. So this kind of tree is represented in the file format. So we define two kinds of elements in this format. One is context. Context defines the period of time where events or other context can occur. And context can be identified with 16 bytes unique ID. For privacy reasons, it's obfuscated by the agent when writing. It's also associated with a name. In this example, DLS handshake client is the context, and it's assigned with this name. And the event is just a moment of time. So, yeah. So this PKRS size is an event. It's kind of single key value pair as an event. So this can be encoded using four primitives we introduce. Context introduction, we use new context, and we support only three event data types, integer, string, or arbitrary sized blob. So let's look at an example. So this is TLS handshake client with a couple of events added from the previous example. So gray rectangles are context. So this, the root context is handshake client. It has two children. One is protocol version event. The other is certificate verify context. And TLS certificate verify context has two children. One is signature algorithm, and the other is RSA size. So if we just write down these events into a file, it will be too insufficient for disk space. So we also added some basic compression and also log rotation mechanism based on the context ID and time window. Yeah, we are not going into the detail. So, yeah, we have plenty of time, so we can do some demo. So we'll cover three scenarios. So first we will do basic operation, and secondly we do visualizing logs, and thirdly we can spot actual problems. So the basic operation is quite simple. You can just access the log with the crypto auditing client. It will connect to the event broker and receive the event and write it down. And afterwards, you can parse the log with this log parser program. So let's see. Sorry, I'm not feeling lucky today, so I'm using the recording. So now we use JSON as the output. So if you access the fedoraproject.org by HTTPS, you receive the events real time. So now we can store the events into the binary file. So we use cbar and storing it to this file. And we do the same. And call the log parser. So as you see, there is a spans, context and spans. Spans contains the children. So it's basically passed it back into the tree. And there's an interesting thing. There's origin value. It's hexadecimal value. That means it matches the build ID of the actual shared library used. So wget is using GNU TLS. So libgnu TLS build ID is embedded in the event itself. And you can also visualize this event as a frame graph. So yeah, we include this script for post-processing. So now take a look at our legacy key derivation process. So We access fedoraproject.org after disabling TLS 1.2. And then we can access this badssl.com, which we know that it doesn't support extended master secret. Now the two handshakes are recorded. And let's look at the frame graph again. We have two handshakes. One has extended master secret here. But the other doesn't have. So this kind of problems can be easily detected with this tool. So let's move back. Actually, we have a way to produce a SQLite file that can be easily imported to Grafana for further analysis. We did this. Let's look at the implementation. So this project is hosted on GitHub under the Ratchet organization. It is written in Rust and they are available on crates.io now, but we recommend using RPM packages because it includes a specific version. It is compiled against the specific version of kernel. So we provide a couple of RPM repositories. One is for the Rust component themselves, and the other is instrumented crypto libraries. There are only on OpenSSL and GNUTLS are there. So, afterwards we measured some performance to ensure that this tool doesn't degrade the system performance as a whole. So we created a simple program that just performed TLS 1.3 handshake 10,000 times. It only uses memory-based transport. So it doesn't do any I/O, and it is interesting to check the performance on single core and multi core systems because BPF program usually involves some context switches. So if any available core, it can be utilized. So we use this command line, and here is the result. First table is the overall time spent. It's in seconds. So in the single core case, there are a bit of degradation that is 4%. And but on 8-core systems, there is nothing or little to no difference. But looking at the context switches, the difference is quite significant. It's almost 7 times more, but we expect that that's because we are not doing any I/O. So if we deploy it on a practical environment, the difference will be much smaller. So future work. So first thing is the instrumentation. This work is still ongoing. We talked with OpenSSL upstream, and they basically agree with this approach. And I'm the GNUTLS developer, so I can push for community adoption. And there are also NSS, libgcrypt, kernel. So we need to think about how to figure out kernel crypto usage as well. As I briefly mentioned that there is a Golang, Golang-based cryptographic code. They are usually statically linked to each application, so it is quite hard to track the usage. So we need to probably figure out how to monitor. Maybe a different mechanism would be needed. So all the miscellaneous stuff. We already support the batch analysis of frame graph using Grafana, but it will be useful if we create a real-time analysis plugin for Grafana. We also should support applications inside a container. Yeah, so basically this is the last slide. So conclusion is that so CryptoGoldting is a tool to identify cryptographic operations happening on system, and it supports long-term and real-time analysis. The architecture is designed to be fast and simple while preserving the privacy. So, any questions? Or comments?
Thank you. So you mentioned that future work includes instrumenting applications that are running inside containers. How do you plan to do that? Doesn't that also require that the USDT instrumented libraries happen to be in those container images that you want to instrument?
I would expect some namespacing at least needed for to collect that information as well as the USDT proofs. So, yeah, I haven't think about it much. Yeah.
Right, but because USDT basically requires you to modify the libraries themselves, that means that the supply chains for building your containers need to also support this.
Yes, so we assume that all the crypto component in the container will be instrumented as well.
All right, thank you.
We have some production services running on Debian and Arc. So how do you suggest that we can use this together, let's say on a Debian service? Because this is only running for, I think, Fedora or Red Hat, is it?
Yeah.
And I was just reading your package. I think it's only released for Fedora. So let's say if we have some services hosted on some other distro. So how can we use this together? Can this run as an agent or?
So the USDT proofs are designed to be quite generic. So if the other distributions are using the similar proof points, we can collect the same information. But we probably should provide some central repository of what would be the event. We can process, so, Did you say about some VPN? No, okay, good. Any other questions? End the presentation, and I'll be at the sponsor stand, so let's talk. Thank you.